And we are back. Welcome. Good evening. Alzheimer's.
What they forget to tell you.
Episode
19, podcast 18.
That's right. We apologize for the earlier disturbance. We're back in full effect. Hopefully now we've got our lives together here. I was asking you before, how was your week?
It was meh.
Oh. Oh.
Meh. What do you do? What do you do?
Meh.
Isn't that like an M-E-H, right? That's an M-E-H?
Yes.
Like a meh. Okay. Yeah.
But not a Trinidadian M-E-H. Like, that's like a Canadian M-E-H.
Oh, okay.
See? Mm. I got the best of both worlds.
Well, it was like a...
Yes, we can see comments now. Hi, Nick. Hello, leading lady. What in the house? What's going down? We got Christian.
What? Christian. It's not Christian.
Listen, put some flair in his name. Maybe he appreciates
I'm
the flair.
I'm pretty sure he doesn't.
So if people just call you Karen.
Yeah, they do, actually.
Well, if somebody called you Karen,
I would hate it.
Hi, Bill.
Hi, Nadira.
Maybe her name is Nadira. Nadira. No? Too soon? Hi, good evening.
I got nothing. I can't even comment. Hi, Karen.
Okay. Okay, let's get right to it because we were on before and we made a few boo-boos. So.
Okay, so you.
Me, let me just start by asking you because there was a couple of podcasts. I think it was two or three podcasts ago where there was an inquiry about your dad and how he dealt with the diagnosis once he found out that your mom actually was officially diagnosed with the disease. As well, I wanted to find out the experience you had seeing your mom go through the death of your father while being sick with this disease as well. I think let's start with that. And I had mentioned earlier, in case you guys are first-time viewers and don't know much of the history, both of our dads have transitioned. Her father was my godfather.
He was.
He was my godfather. And he passed away very recently after her mom got diagnosed with Alzheimer's. So let's talk a little bit about that.
Okay, so to recap, my mom was diagnosed at 57. She was a registered nurse. She was working in Trinidad at Mount Hope Hospital at the time, and she was coming to Toronto to come and help me with my newborn, Jalen. And she was just doing a little bit of out of characteristic things, which, you know,
like,
well, the formula was the big mm-hmm. one. Well, I spoke about it before, but prior to her even arriving in Canada, she kept asking me over and over, when's the baby coming? When's the baby coming? When's the baby coming? And of course, now I know that's one of the signs, right? Repeating questions. And she was asked, I thought she was just really excited,
mm-hmm.
but it was because she couldn't remember every time I told her, like August. And, you know, she's calling me long distance and it's not like every day. So when she called, it didn't dawn on me, like, why is she asking me the same question over and over? It was mm-hmm. just like, oh, she's just really so excited. She can't wait. But anyways, that was, I guess, the first sign. However, when she did come, you know, shortly after I had asked her to mix formula, my son was on formula and she gave it to him concentrate. So I knew for sure something was wrong because she would never make that mistake.
Being a registered nurse, of course not.
Right. So we went to the doctor and he did a mini mental exam, which is usually the first
step
to see. And I just want to say something because my mom was cheating on the exam. Mm-hmm. Yep, she sure was. Like, there's you have to draw a clock, which is usually the first sign that you can tell. And it's sort of, I think it's 10 to 3. I can't remember exactly, but they'll ask you to draw the face of a clock and do a time. And if you have dementia or Alzheimer's, you struggle with that, with knowing where the large hand goes and the small hand goes. And she was looking at the doctor's watch because she was cheating. But then I thought, there's nothing wrong with her. She knows how to cheat. Like, how come she didn't forget how to cheat? Anyways, I digress again. Stay focused. Okay, so needless to say, she didn't do well on that mini mental exam. And I thought it was, again, I thought maybe, you know, you're still in denial too, because they ask you, like, who's the prime minister? And I'm thinking, well,
not everybody knows that in their right mind.
Well, you should. But I mean, my mom lived in Trinidad at the time. So is it fair? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And then they asked her where she was. Like, at my doctor at the time was in the city center upstairs. And then I guess they asked her where she was. And that wasn't fair either, because, like, she technically, you know, I thought they were, like, a little, I think it was biased a little bit, I thought. Mind you, of course, she did have Alzheimer's, so how biased was it?
Let's keep it moving.
All right. Anyways, she had, and then she got the diagnosis. She didn't do well on that test, and he said, and again, I always say no truer words were spoken. He said, your life, she has Alzheimer's, and your life is going to change, and it did immediately. So when I'm not going to edit the story. I was angry with my father, because I would think he should be the one that should have told me that something was wrong, not the other way around.
But I can imagine he was probably in heavy denial.
No, he just, I don't know. He just, things that she stopped doing, he just didn't, like I told you, she stopped cooking. And he was like, huh. Like, things that she did for
all the time,
all her life for you, now she doesn't want to do it, and you didn't think that was weird. But okay, so he didn't know. So I was very angry with him at the very beginning.
So Brianna asked, how did you cope?
At the beginning, I went into go mode. So that's what I do, right? I immediately, it was, okay, well, I need her health card. I need to apply for CPP disability. Like, I went into go, you know, I called my dad. I said I needed all her
information.
And I was very abrupt with him, which I'm, you know, that's a big no-no if you know my dad. But I was. And then, but I guess he understood. He understood why I was upset. Mm-hmm. And then it was a series of appointments. So that, you didn't really have time to think at the beginning. It was just go, go, go,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, it was neurologist appointments. It was, she had to get a brain scan. She went to see Dr. Sandra Black at Sunnybrook. It was just, you know, a slew of appointments. And
were you in immediate, like, find solution mode? Did you still feel like, you know, there were things that you could do to not cure it, but did you believe that it was as bad as it was, or did you think, okay, there's a possibility I could really help her get out of this, or that, you know, she can get back to the way she was before? Or
yeah, because remember, at the beginning, she's not presenting
like she's sick.
Yeah, like it, and it wasn't like immediately I can't remember,
right?
She was still herself, so that part was hard.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and a lot of the times when she was acting out of herself, you had to keep reminding yourself it's the disease and not her.
Well, I think the diagnosis made her change, like, the immediate, you know?
Yeah,
imagine. Soon as she heard those words, Alzheimer's, she immediately became apathetic, depressed, you know, like, it was like a switch.
Of course. Hi, Aunt Pauline. That's Brianna's Aunt Pauline. Hi, Nigel. Hi, Luann. Yeah, I can imagine. I guess that would be something similar if anybody were to get a devastating, you know, piece of news like that about their health, whether it's cancer or any type of other disease. I can't imagine you can just get that type of response and then just think that your life is going to be the same, right?
And I do remember something, like, when my mom lived in Trinidad, she was the private nurse, because see, Alzheimer's was so stigmatized. Now I remember, that she was a private nurse to the president at the time. His wife mm-hmm. developed Alzheimer's, and they just wanted to keep it very hush-hush, so they hired my mom to look after her. So she knew full well what Alzheimer's was firsthand. So I think that's immediately why she became so depressed.
For sure. For sure. Okay, so let's go back to the initial question about your dad. About your mom dealing with your dad's passing while being sick. What kind of experience was that like in terms of having to go through the entire funeral process and, you know, dealing with family and just going through your father's death while you have a sick mom?
That was hard. It was hard because I now had to compartmentalize my feelings. So, and remember, I'm here. I'm here. My mom is there.
Right.
And my brother's there. And, he was obviously in panic mode, shock mode, because my dad had a massive heart attack and he died. He wasn't sick.
Right.
So it was a shock to all of us.
Of course.
And then plus now mom is sick. So it's like, okay. So I remember my brother and, you know, at the time saying to me before I even got there, like, Karen, you cannot react. Like, he basically, I can't grieve. I was not allowed to grieve because if you know anything about Alzheimer's and they're so confused, they're going to mimic your behavior. So if I'm sad, my mom's going to even be sadder, right? And then if she falls into a deep depression, it could be really, really bad.
Yeah, like she doesn't know how to get back out of it.
Right, she wouldn't be able to. And it would be really, really difficult for us
right.
to manage that behavior. So I had to even in the church, no crying. I up to now have not really fully grieved for my father because I haven't had time.
Did she, do you feel like in the moment she knew what was going on? Like, was she still, aware enough to know what was happening, or was she very confused and had no idea what was going on?
No, I think she did, because when I first got there, she's like, Karen, he's dead. Like, dead. I'm like, well, I think she got it. Yeah, she got it.
Mm.
So I was like, yeah, okay. You know, like, I could not react.
Yeah.
Like, so I was like, yeah, he is, yeah. You know? And then, you know, we're Catholic, and typically you bury. That's, you know, in Catholicism, that's typical. Now, there's cremation, but like, I'm pretty sure my dad probably would have wanted to be buried. However, when my brother asked my mom, and he didn't just ask her once, he asked her like on three separate occasions, like,
what's your preference, what do you want
for dad? And she said cremation every single time. So,
mm-hmm.
So she must have known, right? Like, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Got it.
Yeah, that was a tough time. Very tough time.
Sure, for sure. Okay.
We obviously are talking about this for a reason. So, needless to say, unfortunately, when this diagnosis happens, don't do what my dad did. And it was hard. We can't tell my mom what not to do because she's ill. But, like, when you can't talk about the disease, it creates such a problem. And it created, it was double for me because my dad was in denial.
There's no outlet. You have no
right.
outlet.
He's like, he was like, I'm going. Okay, he used to go to these Catholic prayer groups and he's like, she's going to be healed. And I'm like, okay, well, in the interim, let's try to do some other things. But that's my go-to person, and that's what he was saying.
Right.
She's getting prayed for and she'll be healed. And so we didn't talk about
the reality
and next steps. And then now you pass away. Now what?
Left. Yeah.
Now what? You didn't tell me what to do. You didn't guide me. Okay. We didn't make plans.
Yeah. Yeah.
Ugh. But fortunately, my brother is and he's a lawyer, so even double. So, power of attorneys had to be done for my mom.
Right.
Right away.
These are the things that you don't think about at all until you're forced in a position to have to think about it, right? So, okay, Brianna. And I feel like even, you know, going through this, not to totally deter, but, you know, after losing my dad as well a couple of years back, knock on wood, I mean, he was the first person immediately so close frontline to me that I had ever lost, where I had to understand what goes into death and funeral planning and arrangements and tying things up and actually going and making sure that paperwork is done. It was just an overwhelming experience and process, and they don't really make it easier for the person who's grieving. I mean, spouse, children, whoever. Like, I mean, unfortunately, they're doing their job and they have their steps that they need to take. But when you're still going through the shock of losing somebody that you love, it's not an easy process. So that was very eye-opening for me. So I can just imagine how in shock everything was for you with everything happening, bam, 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 all at the same time.
Because my father was in Trinidad at the time, like, and, you know, dual citizenship, things have to be wrapped up in both countries. Like, it's a lot of paperwork, yeah. And a lot of, you know, his last income taxes and then his funeral. And, you know, my brother did a lot of his stuff there, like all of his stuff there. I can't say a lot. He did all of it. And, you know, but then I had mom to deal with. And, you know, so... yeah, it's tough, and it's when you don't talk about it, you're guessing. It's all guesswork at that point.
And winging it, really. I mean, it's tough because, again, you don't really have time to grieve, especially when you're a new mom, and especially when you wear so many hats and you've got responsibilities and you have to work and you have to take care of your kids and you've got to take care of your home and you've got a husband and you've got, you know, the rest of your family and you've got this arrangement and that. Like, it's a lot. It's a lot. So.
And he was, as you know, he was like the head, right? Mm-hmm. He was like the real head of, you know, he was the go-to person.
Yeah.
Like for everything, like for me anyways, like he was my, okay, I don't listen to him, but I still ran everything by him. Like I still appreciated the sounding board.
Yes.
And when he's gone, and then now it's like, uh-oh, we didn't even talk about this. We didn't decide what we're doing with mom, and we didn't have any major conversations about this disease.
Mm-hmm.
And what had happened the last time I saw my father was 9/11. And if I know it's a horrible time, so it's double for me, but he was grounded because he was at an airport conference. He was the manager of the airport, and he was grounded in He was at a conference in Montreal at the time, and he was grounded because he couldn't get a flight back home. So I guess my luck, I got to see my father. Mm. So my parents came, and at least he got to spend time with Jalen. And, you know, at that point, we had an honest conversation, and he was like, yeah, this is tough. Like, he goes, I have to put out your mom's clothes, and I have to help her get dressed. Like, yeah, I guess he finally accepted that
life has changed.
This is the new normal
mm-hmm.
now.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, he died, 2 weeks later. So.
Yeah, that's a tough pill. I mean, regardless, it's always tough. But when it's unexpected like that, that's, you know, with my dad, unfortunately, he was very ill before he passed, but we were given like a full year to at least, you know, have with him and leave nothing unsaid and experience whatever we could, every moment we could. So it was a little bit different. But again, then you see the opposite spectrum of watching the person that you love deteriorate.
That's why I'm picking that one. If I have to pick, I'm signing up for the heart attack.
Oh, your dad, you mean?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Instead of watching this duration.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. I thought you meant your mom, like, no, you want to watch the person deteriorate.
No, no, no.
I want
the heart attack, sudden,
make it fast.
Bye,
yeah.
Sorry, couldn't say goodbye.
Yeah.
Peace out.
Sorry to hear that, leading lady. It's always tough.
Yeah.
It's always tough. Pat, Enzo, good evening. Thank you for watching. So let's change
the channel.
Yeah, because it's a bit...
This is morbid.
whenever we start talking with Daddy, he's like, my heart starts to ache a little bit. So, questions and concerns. You guys, we're always open for whatever topics or anything that you guys have off the top. If you're going through this type of journey and you're confused.
Why don't you tell them about Kai and Lily?
They're much better. They're my tribe has returned.
They're in the mend. Mama Trust Bear. Me, 120%.
Mama Bear is very happy. Mm-hmm. I am very, very relieved. Guys, this flu strain was redonkulous. Like, yes, I said it. Because it was horrific with all capital letters and exclamation points following. It was horrendous. Like, when I think about anybody I don't like, I wouldn't even wish this on them. Okay? That's how bad this thing was. It came through my house like a tsunami. Yes, I said that too. Yes, it did. And it was really bad. 10 days. 10 days my kids were out of it. Fever, diarrhea, vomiting, like bloody noses, just lethargic, could not eat, could not drink, could it was horrible. La, 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 la. So I'm glad that everybody's back on.
I'm gonna answer that question. Sorry.
I'm done.
Well, they're great now. Trust me. They're 110%.
What, my babies?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so how did I... Oh my gosh. I don't know. I really don't know. The question is, how did I manage and do I think it affected my son? Yes, I do. I really do think it affected him. His whole life has been this disease and he's had to just understand that it's PSWs and nurses and, you know, caregivers and, you know, seeing me stressed and I try not to present, but, you know, I'm only human. Sometimes I just, you know, can't take it either. Like this week, that's how it felt this week. It felt heavy. It just felt very heavy.
Sorry to hear that, Abigail. Condolences.
Yeah, sorry to hear that.
This is a tough one today. This is a tough one today.
It was tough, like, I always say, like, I'm part of this group, and sometimes they have funny things, even though they're not funny. Like, we talk about it's funny, but it's not funny.
Yes, it's so funny now, but going through it, no.
But yesterday, what made me laugh was, I'm getting so fed up of the invisible person my mom's talking to.
Got a couple choice words for that person.
I had it with my mom and the invisible person she's talking to. Oh, okay.
Maybe. Well, that was a good laugh. Yeah, that was a nice laugh to be able to, you know, finish us off here because, yeah, it's getting a little...
It's getting heavy. It is heavy. It is. I try to prepare myself every single day and I know I'm not going to be able to.
No, you can't.
Like... You know, yesterday, but it's like a typical day, and I just think, like, this should not be a typical day, but, like, when the nurse comes to check her bed sores, and like I said, they're, like, basically gone now, and then you just see my mom's, like, really thin, like, just bones, and that's hard to watch. It's really hard to watch.
You were making mention of... the amount of views we've been getting recently.
The love.
Guys, that's overwhelming. It's amazing.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, she said she reunited with her childhood play friends. Yeah. Yeah.
So we just wanted to take a minute before we end off here just to really give thanks to all you guys who've been sharing, commenting, watching, our loyal viewers that... consistently come to tune in each week in and week out. It doesn't go unnoticed and it's definitely not underappreciated, or it is appreciated, I should say. We are very grateful for all the support and we hope that you continue to do that and do so that we can fund these wonderful things that you're doing.
Well, you have to do something light. We can't just end on that. Like, this today was, like, really depressing.
Well, sometimes it has to be that way.
No, it can't be. I already had a
meh. Okay, so then you do.
No.
Some,
no
why does
no.
it gotta fall on me?
Because that's just you. You're in entertainment.
I am?
You're a dancer.
I am?
Yeah, I'm not the professional dancer. Nope. Nope, I'm not. Like, I'm a dancer, but.
Okay, Lion Queen. Easy. Easy.
Stop it.
Okay? Don't
Stop
make,
it.
Don't make me pull it.
Stop it right now.
Stop it. Stop it. See, it got you to laugh.
Because that's funny.
Mm-hmm.
That's funny.
Okay, so when I'm a little better, I will share my story.
Okay, yes.
Would love it.
Would love to
yes,
share
we would look
story.
Forward is, to that, Abigail.
You know, if you feel very comfortable, that means a lot too, when you're comfortable.
And open forum. We're all here. No judgment. You know, sharing is caring.
Do it, Wendy. See, do it.
And what you yell? Ew. Oh my!
Come on, just do it.
Do what?
You know.
What are we doing?
Oh.
What are we doing? Tell me.
I don't know. What do you feel
Tell
like
me.
Doing? What's inspiring you?
What
right
are we
now?
Doing? What are we doing? Tell me. Let me hear it. I'm so happy I caught you live. All the way.
I know. She's all the way in Ireland.
Ireland? Well, thank you for that.
I am not busting anyone. They don't know about that.
Aren't you going to Ireland?
Yes.
So you guys can hook up.
We'll do it in person,
you
Lou.
You can do the hook
Lou, we're going to... We're going to...
Whoa. Whoa.
In Dublin. Be there or be...
So what happens in Dublin stays in Dublin. Is that how it goes?
She lives there, so that doesn't work.
Okay, let's end the podcast. Let's.
She see robot.
Let's
they want
end
a robot.
The podcast. See, and you wanted to be a hater every single podcast. What were you doing? The AI without a guy. I'm gonna stop. See, now I'm getting requests. Guys.
Yeah, you're getting. You're like a DJ. I like you to dance the robot. Request number 260. I know, right. I'm looking forward to seeing you too, Lou. It's been so long. I don't even know how many years it's been since I've seen you. And that's terrible. Okay. You're not doing it?
I did it.
Really?
Yeah, that was a 5-second deal.
I think they got gypped.
Oh, coming from Miss Hateration herself.
Look. I didn't say I wanted you to do the robot. You're getting requests from other people.
And there it is.
I didn't say it.
Wait for it.
Other people are requesting it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, too many years.
Oh, I thought you meant too many requests. See? I was just about to do it. See that,
Luann? Too many years.
See that, Luann?
Focus.
Mm-hmm. Lockdown. Locked up. We're done. That's a wrap. I was watching... What was
You're
that
still
show?
Dancing.
What was that show that... Housewife show. It's hilarious. The black girls.
Real Housewives
of Atlanta. And there's another one. There's a Potomac one.
Oh.
Those girls with the... That's what they do in the States. Yeah. I was kind of laughing. My daughter and I was like, I gotta turn this off because she's gonna start doing this stuff. I'm not... Okay, I'm done. Do it, Wendy Robot. No, Luann. No. Luann, you're cut off. We're done. Maybe when, you know, you guys are in Ireland and I tune in to your podcast, I'll be doing my...
Do we have to do there? A river dance? I'm pretty sure that's...
We're going to go now.
I'm trying to be politically correct
Stop
and appropriate.
It. What? Immediately. Effective immediately. Stop the madness.
We'll do river dance. Lou, I said it and I'll say it again.
Isn't that from Scotland?
No, it's Irish.
Okay, gotta go, guys. Thank you for thank you for watching as usual. We are very grateful. You guys have a blessed week. We will see you next week. And if there's any questions, concerns, or topics that you want us to cover or talk about, hit her up in the DM. The DM.
What does DM stand for those that are not technologically inclined?
In the inbox.
Okay. Direct message.
Yes,
that's
in
what
the
it
inbox.
Stands for.
Yes. We love you all.
And we have to say thank you. You started that, but we have 11,000 views.
Sorry. share, keep sharing.
Yeah, so please share. Share,
keep sharing.
We appreciate it. Look, it's all the way in Ireland. That's one.
This is the worm.
Are you sure that's the worm?
It is now.
No, the worm is that thing you do on the ground. Like, I'm not doing it. But like, you know, that's not the worm.
Peace and love. We will see you next week. Guys, be blessed. Stay healthy. Okay? Love each other. Bye.